Good morning, good afternoon, or good evening, whatever time you may be watching this particular telecast. We just want to say thank you so much for coming to join us again. We have a very powerful message for this particular session. Our first two messages have gone through a lot of things as it pertains to the second coming of Christ and also what our Lord and Savior is currently doing right now in the most holy place of the heavenly sanctuary. And as we continue along that line, we're going to especially pray that God's Spirit may abide with us, because there is very much truth that we're going to go through, and we really need the Holy Spirit to give us the proper wisdom and understanding that we can properly comprehend that which the Lord is going to communicate. So without further ado, I'm going to have a word of prayer, and by God's grace, we will begin. Dear Father in heaven, Lord, we just come before you, thanking you for this time and opportunity to be able to study your word in depth. I pray, dear Lord, that you would please focus our hearts and our minds. These truths demand that we tax our minds and understanding. And I know that for a very long time, many of us have not been used to this amount of taxation, myself included. And I just pray, dearly Father, that you would help us, as it were, to put on our spiritual thinking caps so that we can properly comprehend again that which you are going to communicate. We thank you so much for our online audience. We pray that those who are watching here at home in Africa and around the world may be tremendously blessed. And we pray all of this in Jesus' name. Amen. All right. Now, let's open up our Bibles to the book of Matthew. This is just as a means of review, the book of Matthew. Matthew chapter 24, and we're going to read in verse 14. All right, the Bible says, "And this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in all the world for a witness unto all nations, and then shall the end come." So the Bible clearly communicates here that the only way that Christ is going to come back is that there needs to be a final and full display of the love of God. And we see this very clearly here in Matthew, the 24th chapter. We saw also as well that since 1844, on October 22nd, that Christ has been ministering in the most holy place of the heavenly sanctuary. And that great work that he went there to complete is going to determine the nature of a vast amount of things, especially as it relates to the great controversy to which you and I are currently engaged. And in light of that as well, let's turn in our Bibles to the book of Revelation. Because besides this investigative judgment, this cleansing of the sanctuary, these things taking place, we saw also as well that there is a work of judgment that is going forward. Revelation chapter 14, starting in verse 6. Notice what the Bible says. "And I saw another angel fly in the midst of heaven, having the everlasting gospel to preach unto them that dwell on the earth, and to every nation and kindred and tongue and people, saying with a loud voice, Fear God and give glory to him, for the hour of his judgment is come. It says, and worship him that made heaven and earth and the sea and the fountains of waters." So we see here very clearly that on October 22nd, 1844, that this judgment began. Also as well in our previous session, we saw very clearly that this judgment began not with the living, but with the dead. And we read that in Revelation chapter 11, verses 18 and 19. And in light of that, we're going to take a look at our screen, and we see here an artist's rendition of Christ ministering in the most holy place of the heavenly sanctuary. Notice what this says. This is from a gentleman by the name of Stephen Haskell. Again, one of the great pioneers of the Seventh-day Adventist movement. Notice this. Notice what he says in a book that he wrote called The Story of the Seer of Patmos. "As foretold in the scriptures, the ministration of Christ in the most holy place began at the termination of the prophetic days in 1844. We saw that very clearly. The words of the Revelator applied to this time, the temple of God was open in heaven, and there was seen in his temple the Ark of his Testament. At the beginning of the work of the investigative judgment, when Christ entered the most holy place, the door in heaven was open and the law of God was seen as the foundation of his throne. It was immediately after the bitter disappointment of 1844, when earnest souls were still searching the scriptures, that the sacredness of the law was revealed. So we see here very clearly that the standard in the investigative judgment is the law of God. And the Bible tells us this very clearly in the book of James. The book of James tells us that we are going to be judged by the law of liberty. And again, contrary to popular opinion, the law of God is not a law of bondage. It is a law of liberty. The Bible says, whom the Son sets free, he is free indeed. It's not a law of bondage. All right, so we saw here as well that the investigative judgment began with the dead. We see here on our screen a symbol of a hearse with a coffin in it. A symbol of a hearse with a coffin in it. This is taken from a book called True Revival and again, The Great Controversy. This says, in 1844, our great high priest entered the most holy place of the heavenly sanctuary to begin the work of the investigative judgment. The cases of the righteous dead have been passing in review before God. Solemn are the scenes connected with the closing work of the atonement. Momentous are the interests involved therein. The judgment is now passing in the sanctuary above. For more than 40 years, this work has been in progress. So in context, that book, Great Controversy, was written in 1888. So it had roughly been about 40 years since the passing of the time of 1844 when this particular statement that we just read was originally penned. So as a result of that, it was saying that the investigative judgment of the dead had been going on for about 40 years. Now back to the screen, we see here a symbol of the gentleman J.N. Andrews, another one of the Seventh-day Adventist pioneers. Notice what this is. In a book that he wrote called The Judgment, Its Events and Its Order. It says, the events under the sounding of the seventh angel, though not given in chronological order, are from their nature not difficult to be arranged in the order of their occurrence. While Christ is finishing his priesthood at the tribunal of his Father, in the holiest of the heavenly temple, the judgment of the righteous dead takes place. So this is merely re-emphasizing the point that the investigative judgment of the dead began when Jesus entered into the most holy place. But we're about to see that there is not only an investigative judgment of the dead, but there is also an investigative judgment of the living. And the living is of actually more consequence than the judgment of the dead, and we'll see why. All right, this is a symbol of life. This is a symbol of life. Now, we're actually going to see why the investigative judgment of the living is of such important consequence. Notice this. Returning back to Revelation 14, which we were in already. Revelation chapter 14, starting in verse 6. Now, we're going to go through this systematically and see the nature of these things. Verse 6. It says, and I saw another angel fly in the midst of heaven, having the everlasting gospel to preach unto the earth. To preach unto them that dwell on the earth, and to every nation and kindred tongue and people, saying with a loud voice, notice, fear God and give glory to him, for the hour of his judgment is come, and worship him that made heaven and earth, and the sea and the fountains of waters. Now again, we want to understand this intelligently. If the investigative judgment began with the dead, this first message that we see in verses 6 and 7, does this primarily have an application with the investigative judgment of the dead or the investigative judgment of the living? And clearly, from the testimony of the scriptures, we see here that it primarily relates to the investigative judgment of the living. And this is the reason why. Let's turn in our Bibles to the book of Isaiah, and let's notice what the Bible says in the book of Isaiah. Now remember again, we want to find out these three angels' messages that we read in Revelation chapter 14. We want to understand, does this primarily relate to the dead or does it primarily relate to the living? Notice, Isaiah chapter 38. Notice what the Bible says in Isaiah chapter 38. Isaiah chapter 38, and we're going to read in verse, we're going to start in verse 17. Notice what the Bible says. Behold, for peace I had great bitterness, but thou hast in love to my soul delivered it from the pit of corruption. Now in the word of God, the pit is merely a symbol of the grave. For thou hast cast all my sins behind thy back. Verse 18. For the grave cannot praise thee, death cannot celebrate thee, they that go down into the pit cannot hope for thy truth. Notice verse 19. The living, he shall praise thee as I do this day. The Father to the children shall make known thy truth. So if we connect that with Revelation chapter 14, verse 6 and 7, though the investigative judgment did begin with the dead, it is primarily talking about the investigative judgment of the living. For as we clearly saw from Isaiah chapter 38, that it is only the living that can properly give glory to God. Yes, it is true that if we have lived a faithful life, the Bible does say that our works do follow us, but it is primarily those of us who still have the breath of life contained within us that can actually give God glory. You see, because contrary to popular opinion, when we die, we cannot give glory to God. When we die, the Bible makes it very clear that whether we die in Christ or whether we die as a wicked person, we are simply resting in the grave, either awaiting the first or the second resurrection. There is no intermediary period. And so the Bible is clearly communicating that this three angels' messages was primarily referring to the investigative judgment of the living. And we're going to see this very, very clearly a little bit more as we turn back to the screen. So we see here a symbol of life, a symbol of a person living, enjoying the beauty of the sun and the beauties of air and of nature. Notice. Again, this is from True Revival and the Great Controversy. This says, when the work shall be completed, judgment is to be pronounced upon the living. Soon, none know how soon, it will pass to the cases of the living. And you see, brethren, we could spend a lot of time delineating these points, but just to encapsulize, God wants us to understand this present reality. You see, the investigative judgment of the living, of the dead, rather, has been going on for a very long time. And as we just read, soon, none know how soon, it will pass to the cases of the living. And as the Bible is going to actually communicate to us, this judgment of the living is soon to commence. God has actually given the great indication that will clearly communicate to our minds when the investigative judgment will pass to the cases of the living, and we're going to see this very clearly before we close this message. All right, now going to the screen, we see here a symbol of a clock, and we see here a symbol of the earth, and we see that this clock is soon to strike midnight. This clock is soon to strike midnight. Now, in light of that, we're going to turn in our Bibles to the book of Matthew. We're going to turn in our Bibles back to the book of Matthew, Matthew chapter 25. Matthew chapter 25. Now remember, we want to understand when this investigative judgment of the living is going to take place. When this investigative judgment of the living is going to take place. Notice what the Bible says in Matthew chapter 25. Matthew chapter 25. Now this is just for the sake of context. Matthew 24 actually talks about the events that pertain to Christ's second coming, but Matthew 25 gives the spiritual experience of God's people that is connected to his second coming. So again, whereas Matthew 24 gives the events and the signs, Matthew 25 helps to give the spiritual experience. Matthew 25, starting in verse 1, the Bible says, then shall the kingdom of heaven be likened unto 10 virgins. Now, we're not, again, going to go through all of this just for the sake of time, but the reason why the Bible describes them as virgins is because they profess to have a pure faith. It says, which took their lamps and went forth to meet the bridegroom. Now, in the Word of God, a lamp is the representation of the Word of God. Now, we're not going to turn to it, but you can write in your notes Psalm chapter 119, verse 105, that very famous text that says that the word of God is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. All right, so in verse 2 it says, and five of them were wise and five were foolish, talking about the classes of people. They that were foolish took their lamps and took no oil with them. Now again, in the word of God, in this context, oil is a representation of the Holy Spirit. You can go read about that in Zechariah chapter 4. It says, but the wise took oil in their vessels with their lamps. While the bridegroom tarried, they all slumbered and slept. Notice, verse 6. And at midnight there was a cry made, behold, the bridegroom cometh, go ye out to meet him. Now the bridegroom, I believe that we can understand who the bridegroom is a representation of. That is a representation of Jesus Christ. This is giving a bird's eye view of the spiritual experience of God's people right before the second coming of Christ. But notice in verse 6 it says, and at midnight there was a cry made, behold, the bridegroom cometh, go ye out to meet him. This is the question. Is the midnight cry the second coming? I'll ask it again. Is the midnight cry the second coming of Jesus Christ? No, yes. As we see very clearly, the midnight cry is actually not the second coming of Christ. You know that there is a very famous Christian song that says, and at the midnight cry, we will be going home. And many times we have made it synonymous, the midnight cry, with the second coming. But the Bible is actually going to explain why the midnight cry could not be the second coming. Notice what it says in verse 7. Then all those virgins arose and trimmed their lamps, and the foolish said unto the wise, give us of your oil, for our lamps are gone out. But the wise answered, saying, not so, lest there be not enough for us and you, but go ye rather to them that sell and buy for yourselves. And while they went to buy, the bridegroom came, and they that were ready went in with him to the marriage. That there is representing the second coming of Christ, as it were. So by default, if the midnight cry is before the bridegroom actually comes, the midnight cry cannot be the second coming, but merely the declaration that his coming is even at the door. Does that make sense? Yes. And so in light of that, we see here very clearly that the midnight cry is not the second coming, but merely the declaration that the second coming of Christ is near. Now, we want to understand, when is or what is the midnight cry? Now, in light of that, let's turn our Bibles to the book of Revelation 14. Now, some of us who are watching this, who may be clued into some of the historical context of these prophecies, know that in the summer and the spring of 1844, that was the prophetic fulfillment of the midnight cry. But we are also going to see that there is a dual application to this prophecy. Notice, Revelation 14, starting in verse 6 again. Notice the sequence of how God coupled this three angels' messages. Again, we're talking about the investigative judgment of the living. And I saw another angel fly in the midst of heaven, having the everlasting gospel to preach unto them that dwell on the earth, and to every nation and kindred and tongue and people, saying with a loud voice, fear God and give glory to him, for the hour of his judgment is come, and worship him that made heaven and earth and the sea and the fountains of waters. And there followed another angel, saying, Babylon is fallen, that great city, because she made all nations drink of the wine of the wrath of her fornication. Now let's try to couple this together. So we saw that verse 6 and 7, though it has an application to the investigative judgment of the dead, it primarily relates to the investigative judgment of the living. And coupled with that, in this investigative judgment of the living, there's also the declaration that Babylon is making all nations drink of the wine of the wrath of her fornication. Now we're going to turn in our Bibles to the book of Proverbs and see what happens when we drink wine in a spiritual context. Notice, Proverbs chapter 31. Let's notice what the Bible says in Proverbs chapter 31. Notice what the Bible says in Proverbs 31. Proverbs chapter 31. Notice what the Bible says starting in verse 3. Notice what the Bible says. Give not thy strength unto women, nor thy ways to that which destroyeth kings. Verse 4. It is not for kings, O Lemuel, it is not for kings to drink wine, nor for princes strong drink. Notice, verse 5. Lest they drink and forget the law and pervert the judgment of any of the afflicted. So notice this. This is powerful. So the Bible is saying that when the investigative judgment passes to the cases of the living, Babylon will then make all nations drink of the wine of the wrath of her fornication, thus making them forget the law. Does that make sense? Now notice, now let's think about this. What is the only commandment in the Decalogue where God said that we needed to remember it? Yes, it's the Sabbath. So the Bible is saying that when the investigative judgment passes to the cases of the living, Babylon will make all nations forget the law, particularly the seventh day Sabbath, the fourth commandment of the Word of God. So we see that very clearly. Now, in light of that, we're going to turn in our Bibles back to the book of Revelation, chapter 14. Now, dear family, I know that we're going over a lot of truth. And I certainly know that, especially for probably most of us, we're not going to fully comprehend everything that's being communicated. So I highly encourage you to take out a pen and paper, take notes, and you can even pause us. The blessing of these telecommunication agencies is that we can always go back and watch them. So Revelation chapter 14, we're going to pick up in verse 9. So we see here the investigative judgment of the living, Babylon making all nations forget the law, particularly the fourth commandment. And in addition, we're going to see what time period this is going to take place. Notice verse 9. Then the third angel followed them, saying with a loud voice, "If any man worship the beast and his image and receive his mark in his forehead or in his hand, the same shall drink of the wine of the wrath of God, which is poured out without mixture into the cup of his indignation." Now, we're not going to read the rest of it going through verse 12, but the Bible clearly reveals here that this beast power, when this beast power ascends into complete domination, this is when this great investigative judgment will pass to the cases of the living. Now, the question is, who is the beast? Now, again, for the sake of time, we're not going to go through all the details, but very many Bible expositors, all of these sincere Protestant biblical historians and prophetic scholars all agree that the first beast of Revelation 13 was the papacy, the Roman Catholic institution with the Pope of Rome as its head. It was even during the fires of the Reformation, as Martin Luther was going to speak before the Diet, that Martin Luther said that the Pope of Rome was not only our Lord's adversary, but also the apostle of Satan. And so this was a very unanimous point of biblical understanding that was heavily agreed upon, but unfortunately this has been greatly lost. So the Bible is clearly here communicating that this investigative judgment of the living is completely tied into the papacy, the Pope of Rome coming back into ascendancy, establishing and making persons forget the fourth commandment of the Decalogue. Now, what we're going to do, we want to see this very, very clearly. We want to see this very, very clearly. This is taken from manuscript releases in the Spirit of Prophecy. Now, I know that we have not really fully established this point, but you see here the remnant church that the Bible speaks of in Bible prophecy in Revelation chapter 17 and verse 12, it says that this remnant would have the commandments of God and the testimony of Jesus Christ. And Revelation 19:10 tells us that the testimony of Jesus Christ is the spirit of prophecy. Now, the only movement that could possibly qualify to meet the specifications of that prophecy is the Seventh-day Adventist movement. The Bible also expounded in Revelation 13 and 14 that this movement would have to arise after 1798. Revelation 12 actually talks about that as well. And so again, the only movement that would possibly qualify to meet the specifications of the prophecy is the Seventh-day Adventist movement. Now, in light of that, we're going to read this statement from the Spirit of Prophecy, the testimony of Jesus Christ as manifested in the labors of Ellen G. White. Notice this. God's purpose in giving the third angel's message to the world is to prepare a people to stand true to him during the investigator judgment. This is the purpose for which we establish and maintain our publishing houses, our schools, our sanitariums, hygienic restaurants, treatment rooms, and food factories. This is our purpose in carrying forward every line of work in the cause. And you see, the reason why this statement is so important is that it clearly delineates that the real crux of the message is not dealing with the investigative judgment of the dead, but primarily the investigative judgment of the living. Because by default, how can a school, a publishing house, or a hygienic restaurant help a dead person? Can a dead person eat? Can a dead person get well? Can a dead person worship God in a sanctuary? No, it cannot. This primarily is for and exclusively for those who are in the land of the living. Those who are in the land of the living. Now, again, on our screen, we see here a symbol of the beast power of Revelation 13. The beast power of Revelation 13. Now, what we want to understand, we're about to go through some details and see how the papacy is ascending back into power, going to use its influence to enforce these legislations that we read in the Word of God. And in light of that, let's turn in our Bibles to the to Revelation chapter 13. Let's notice this. Revelation chapter 13, and we're going to read in verse 12. Revelation 13 and verse 12. Notice what the Bible says. Actually, we'll start at 11 for the sake of context. It says, "And I beheld another beast coming up out of the earth, and he had two horns like a lamb, and he spake as a dragon." Now, we're not going to go through, again, for the sake of time, but for context, this second beast of Revelation 13 is describing the rise and progress of the United States of America. Now, verse 12, it says, "And he exerciseth all the power of the first beast before him, and causeth the earth and them which dwell therein to worship the beast, the first beast, whose deadly wound was healed." So the Bible is prophesying that from its very inception, the United States would be manifesting the same tyrannical principles that the papacy was exercising during its complete domination of Western Europe during the Dark and Middle Ages. And the question is, has the United States actually done this? And the answer is, yes, it has. And we can see this clearly demonstrated by the mass degradation of the Native Americans, the mass persecution of other religious sects and bodies, and also we can't forget the slavery of black Africans. Now notice this, as we go to our screen. Now remember, we're about to go through quite a bit of history, and we're going to see how the United States is using its influence along with the papacy in order to bring about this state of despotism upon the entire planet. Notice this. On our screen is a symbol of something called apostate Protestantism. Apostate Protestantism. This is a symbol of the merging of church and state. And contrary to popular opinion, the merging of church and state is not a good thing. There's even many Christians in the United States who believe that church and state should be connected. But people do not understand that anytime church and state is connected, it always leads to the persecution of those who do not agree with their dogmas. Notice. Now, this is a symbol of apostate Protestantism. These are two authors from the United States who wrote upon a principle called Christian nationalism. Christian nationalism, we're about to see, is one of the great mechanisms, sadly, that Satan is using to bring a great amount of despotism, not only in the United States, but around the world. Notice. Notice what they say in this particular volume as it pertains to Christian nationalism. Simply put, Christian nationalism is a cultural framework, a collection of myths, traditions, symbols, narratives, and value systems that idealizes and advocates a fusion of Christianity and American civic life. You see, very many times we, especially those of us who live in the United States, we are told as Americans that the United States is the greatest country, not only currently in the world, but the greatest nation that has ever existed. And as a result of this greatness, this American exceptionalism, this gives us the right to do whatever we want in the world. But this is false. Notice at the bottom, it says, "On the contrary, the Christianity of Christian nationalism represents something more than religion. This says, as we will show, it includes assumptions of nativism, white supremacy, patriarchy, and heteronormativity, along with divine sanction for authoritarian control and militarism." This is one of the great reasons why we as the United States, we love to spread our democracy around the entire world. It says, "In its self-identity, interpretations of its own history, sacred symbols, cherished values, and public policies, it aims to keep it that way. Now, on our screen here, we have a symbol of a gentleman by the name of Colin Kaepernick. Now, for those of us who remember this epoch in American history, Colin Kaepernick was protesting many of the injustices that were taking place to black Americans and persons of color in general. Now, sadly, there were even very many Christians who were not only lambasting this man, but were even, you know, making threats to him and all of these other different type of things, as if this man was doing something that was sacrilegious. But we are about to find out that, again, many of us as Americans, as United States citizens, we have been so brainwashed that we have come to actually see the United States as divine itself. Notice, this is a gentleman by the name of C.P. Bowman, a Seventh-day Adventist writer who wrote around the turn of the 20th century. Notice what he says about some of these epochs as it pertained to Colin Kaepernick, just talking about the principle. Obviously, he wasn't writing around the time of Colin Kaepernick, but we get the point. All right, this says, the thoughts thus expressed by Judge Ferris are right in line with the flag salute introduced in many places in the public schools. We give our heads and hearts to God and our country, one language, one flag. Notice, bending the knee in reverence is an act of worship. Hence, it is an act that might very properly be refused on religious grounds. Notice, the Romans held that the state was divine. Indeed, the Roman state was the chief divinity. I wonder if, especially as United States citizens, we have been conditioned to believe that the government, the federal government, is divine. Continuing, there is nothing divine about the flag. I'll read it again. There is nothing divine about the flag. Only as the flag stands for liberty and justice is it worthy of respect. Blind devotion to one flag as the symbol of governmental power merely is no more praiseworthy than is blind devotion to another flag. It says the candidate for American citizenship should be required to familiarize himself with the Declaration of Independence and the Constitution of the United States. Notice at the bottom, he should advocate a policy of education, not one of meaningless form and hollow profession. So we see here clearly from C.P. Bowman that all of this hysteria that was made as it pertained to kneeling during the national anthem was nothing more than propaganda to make American citizens believe that protesting government injustices, that there's something wrong with it. Because even if you disagree with what Colin Kaepernick was doing, principally, those actions were protected under the Constitution. It's amazing that we're willing to come to the defense of rules when they favor us, but as it pertains to someone else, we're not really willing to defend their right to exercise their freedoms as well. All right, on our screen we have a symbol of a woman by the name of Marjorie Taylor Greene, Doug Mastriano, and Laura Bombert. These particular individuals, they consider themselves Christian nationalists. And as you can see on the screen, the ethnicity of these individuals, you can see that they're all white. You see, unfortunately, Satan is using especially this race issue in order to cause a great amount of division. Because again, associated with this Christian nationalism is also a very strong push towards white supremacy, but it's not overt, but it's covert. Notice, and again, I don't want this to be confused. For those of our white brethren who may be watching this telecast, this is not as a means of defamation upon any person because of skin color. We're merely objectively going over these principles that pertain to Bible prophecy. Notice. So this says, the rise of theocracy among conservatives. We're not going to go through this. Marjorie Taylor Greene says GOP should be Christian nationalists. And you know what's so sad about many of these persons that advocate these so-called Christian principles? And I don't say this to be antagonistic. This dear sister, Marjorie Taylor Greene, you know, God bless her heart, God have mercy on her soul. This woman literally just went through a divorce. And according to the information that I was reading, She went through a divorce because she was committing adultery with another man. So this woman who is trying to inculcate Christian nationalism is also committing adultery. I mean, the hypocrisy is literally astounding. All right, we're going to go past this. Again, the symbol of Christian nationalism. These are pastors courting the favor of Donald Trump. And it wasn't just Donald Trump. Pastors have, especially in the United States, have very routinely courted the friendship of political figures. It wasn't just Donald Trump. It was Obama, Bush, Clinton, all of them. All right, we're going to skip past this. 7-point plan. Skip past this. God bless this dear man's heart, a man by the name of Louis Giglio. This man's Atlanta megachurch pastor, Louis Giglio, sets off firestorm by calling slavery a blessing to whites. You know, there's this concept of white privilege. And again, we're not saying this to be antagonistic against our white brothers and sisters, but there is an objective reality that as a result of colonialism, that many white brethren had privileges that other classes of people did not enjoy. But unfortunately, because some white brethren can't understand that notion, they get very triggered when they hear that point. And so in order to dumb down the offense that some white brethren felt, not all, but some that some white brethren felt, this pastor said, don't call it white privilege, call it white blessing. You know, it's amazing. I've even heard Christians say that colonialism was a blessing because it gave way for Christianity to be spread among the nations. I mean, this is literally insanity. All right, we're going to skip past this. All right, now we're going to get down to some of the very roots of the issue. Now, on our screen here, we have a symbol of the Puritans. Now, for those who know American history, the Puritans came to the quote-unquote New World in 1620 as a result of the Mayflower. Notice, this is taken from a man by the name of A.T. Jones, one of the greatest intellectual and spiritual minds that was ever blessed in the Seventh-day Adventist movement. Notice, this says, they were so persecuted, talking about the Puritans, and abused by all classes as well as by the officers of the law, that in 1608 they fled to Holland, stopping first in Amsterdam. From there, a company of these pilgrims sailed and landed at Plymouth, New England in 1620. Was not here an opportunity to establish a complete and unabridged Puritan government? You see, when the Puritans came to the New World, they were actually trying to establish a theocracy. They were not trying to establish a country where there was civil and religious liberty. They were trying to set up a completely full and complete theocracy where the church would dominate every aspect of the nation. And that is not a biblical principle. Now remember, again, I know we're going over a lot of information, but the reason why we're delineating this history is to get an understanding as to why the United States is going to use its influence in order to prop up the papacy, thus helping to signal that the investigative judgment has passed to the cases of the living. Notice, we're going to skip past. This says a Puritan in the middle, in the words in blue, a Puritan or Calvinistic government was at once established and put into working order. Thus, in the polity, in the middle, thus the polity became a theocracy. God himself was to govern his people, and the saints by calling were by the fundamental law of the colony constituted the oracle of the divine will. This is exactly the position they occupied. They were consulted, speaking to pastors, they were consulted in everything, and everything must be subject to their dictation. Now again, we want to understand this intelligently. The papacy, the Roman Catholic institution, is a professed Christian institution masquerading around as Christian, but in reality using its influence in order to inculcate principles of despotism. And the Bible was prophesying in Revelation 13 that the United States would be the same way, a quote-unquote Christian nation masquerading around as Christian, but at the same time using its power in order to inculcate principles of despotism. Notice, now this is a symbol of what Americans call Thanksgiving, and contrary to popular opinion, the Indians and the Puritans as a whole were not singing Kumbaya. This says the gooey overlay of sweetness over genocide, the myth of the first Thanksgiving. Again, contrary to popular opinion, you know, the Puritans as a whole, not all of them, but the Puritans as a whole did not come to the Indians with goodwill and try to do them the best that they could. Let's see this. Now, this is a particular professor of history at the University of Hawaii. He wrote a very powerful volume called, I believe it was American Genocide, but we'll see the title. This man delineates in this book the reality of the savage butchery that was heaped upon the Native Americans by the Puritans. The destruction of the Indians of the Americas was far and away the most massive act of genocide in the history of the world. This is why, as one historian aptly has said, far from the heroic and romantic heraldry that customarily is used to symbolize the European settlement of the Americas, the emblem most congruent with reality would be a pyramid of skulls. You see, when the Puritans came to North America, they imagined that they were the children of Israel going into the promised land. Now, if they were the children of Israel going into the promised land by default, those that were in the promised land would be seen as Canaanites. And we know from history, from the Bible record, that God commanded the children of Israel to drive out the Canaanites and to destroy them and all of the other nations that were occupying eventually. So as a result of this skewed understanding of Bible prophecy, the Puritans sadly heaped a massive amount of genocide upon the Native Americans. And even to this day, the Native Americans in North America have never had their civil and religious liberty respected by the American government. The American government literally just mass migrated them to vast tracts of land in no man's land in the middle of America and gave them some of the worst land in the States. It's a very sad history. All right, we're going to skip past this. This is a symbol of a woman by the name of Mary Dyer. She was a Quaker who was persecuted by the Puritans because she believed doctrinally different from the Puritans. Again, this is the religious legacy of North America. Remember this. All right, we're going to skip past. All right, we're coming down to our last slide. This is a symbol of the fusion of church and state. The fusion of church and state. Now, this is a man by the name of P.T. McGann. Again, one of the greatest educational minds ever given to the Seventh-day Adventist movement. Notice what he says about the initial stages of the United States. The advent of the United States upon the history stage broke the dawn of a new era, not alone for the 13 colonies, but for all mankind. The principles of freedom enunciated in the immortal Declaration of Independence were pregnant with real for tens of thousands. At the bottom, the Declaration of Independence and the Constitution of the U.S. are indeed the New and Old Testaments in things pertaining to Caesar, the one serving as a commentary in the light of which the other must be interpreted. So in principle, the Declaration and the of Independence and the Constitution are literally one of the greatest civil documents that have ever been created and penned by human hands. But unfortunately, the United States has always severely struggled to actually follow these principles. All right, on our screen, we have a symbol of something called the Treaty of Tripoli. Now, again, we're not going to go through the details of this. We have more information about these concepts in other alternative videos, and we'll give some links to that later. All right, this is a symbol of the Treaty of Tripoli as we seek to bring this to a close. In this Treaty of Tripoli, it was declared that the United States wasn't a Christian nation. This was taken back to 1797. Notice this. As the government of the United States of America is not in any sense founded on the Christian religion, as it has in itself no character of enmity against the laws, religion, or tranquility of Muslim men. So the United States was declaring around the turn of the 18th century that the United States was not a Christian, it was not a Christian nation. Now, this may actually be confusing to some people because it's always been declared that the United States was a Christian nation. Now, the United States is only Christian as it adheres to the principles that church and state should be separated. But it was never God's will that Christianity as a religion was to be embedded into the civil code of the nation, because that by default would lead to despotism. All right, unfortunately, this concept of civil and religious liberty was revoked around the turn of the 20th century. Now, this was a particular Supreme Court decision in 1892, and this was a particular Supreme Court justice that was reigning at that time. And at the very bottom, it was declared that the United States was a Christian nation. So by default, these principles of religious and civil liberty were being revoked around this time. All right, we're going to skip past this. It's possible we may come back to this later. This is a lot of powerful history, but we don't have time to go through it. Again, this is A.T. Jones. Notice what this says. In the middle, and thus the government of the United States has, in principle and for the Philippines in practice, deliberately and expressly repudiated every principle of its constitution as a republican government. Not a single item, nor even an iota of the principle of republican or constitutional government remains. National apostasy from Christian principle is complete. So around the turn of the 20th century, the United States in principle had completely revoked its idealized principles of civil and religious liberty. And so you see, brothers and sisters, in reality, we are living on borrowed time. God is not waiting for the papacy. As we're going to see, God is not waiting for the United Nations, the World Economic Forum. God is not waiting for the Council on Foreign Relations. The only thing that God is waiting is for the manifestation of his character in his people. That's the only thing God is waiting for. Notice, when the leading churches of the United States, uniting upon such points of doctrine as are held by them in common, shall influence the state to enforce their decrees and to sustain their institutions, then Protestant America will have formed an image to the Roman hierarchy, and the infliction of civil penalties upon dissenters will inevitably result. You see, many times when many of us as Seventh-day Adventists have read this statement, we have projected that the fulfillment of this was far into the future. But the reality is that these leading churches of the United States have already united upon such points of doctrine. Again, the only reason why Jesus has not come back, the only reason why the National Sunday Law and all of these things have not taken place is because God is merely holding back the winds of strife. But the reality is that God cannot hold them forever, and he won't. There is a limit to how long God is going to permit sin to reign upon this planet. All right, we're bringing this to a close. Trump's Zionist philo-Semitism, this is just bringing out the principle that this Christian nationalistic ideology is helping to fuel the foreign policy of the United States. All right, skip past this. How Bible prophecy shapes Trump's foreign policy. And again, I don't want us to be confused, because this is not just with Donald Trump. It was also with Barack Obama. It was also with George W. Bush II. It was also with Bill Clinton, Papa Bush, Ronald Reagan, Jimmy Carter, the whole nine. And unfortunately, especially for those of us as Americans, even many of us around the world, we are conditioned to believe that there is some sort of difference between the left and the right. You see, politics as it is played in the world today is nothing more than theater. It is a show. It's a game, merely to condition the citizens of the world's population to believe that they have some say in global affairs. All right, we're going to go past this. And this is one of the great reasons why, as Christians, our primary concern should not be world politics, but the salvation of souls. All right. Now, again, we read this statement already in some of our previous messages talking about the futurist school of Bible interpretation. This is, again, one of the great reasons why so many evangelicals believe that the Jews are still God's chosen people as a result of the Jesuits and their infiltration into prophetic schools of study. All right. We're going to skip past this. Now, this is two gentlemen by the name, again, of A.T. Jones and E.J. Wagner. They were preaching a message of righteousness by faith. All right, this is from the Review and Herald. This is going to be our last statement. This says, the time of test is just upon us, for the loud cry of the third angel has already begun in the revelation of the righteousness of Christ, the sin-pardoning Savior. You see, dear friends, as we see the powers that be using their influence in order to dominate the world's population, we should be seeking in earnest to inculcate and to spread the three angels' messages. And again, contrary to popular opinion, the very root of the three angels' messages is not the papacy. The root of the three angels' messages is not apostate Protestantism, but it's the righteousness of Christ. Because the only way that we are going to escape the onslaught that Satan is going to heap upon this planet is that we must be hid in Christ. And in light of that, we're going to turn in our Bibles to the book of Psalms. And we're going to close on this book, close on this point. Psalms chapter 91. This is a text of scripture that I know that very many of us are familiar with. Very powerful statement, as it was prophetically speaking of the experience of God's people at the end of time. Notice this. Psalm 91, starting in verse 1. He that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, He is my refuge and my fortress. My God, in Him will I trust. Surely He shall deliver thee from the snare of the fowler and from the noisome pestilence. He shall cover thee with His feathers, and under His wings shalt thou trust. His truth shall be thy shield and buckler. Thou shalt not be afraid for the terror by night, nor for the arrow that flieth by day, nor for the pestilence that walketh in darkness, nor for the destruction that wasteth at noonday. 1,000 shall fall at thy side, and 10,000 at thy right hand, but it shall not come nigh thee. Only with thine eyes shalt thou behold and see the reward of the wicked. You see, brothers and sisters, again, if we are going to make it through the time that is coming, we must be hid under the shadow of the Almighty, and especially in light of the investigative judgment of the living. If we are going to pass this judgment by God's grace, we must have His righteousness. And in light of that, my appeal is very, very simple. If it is your desire to be prepared for the time that is coming, and even more importantly, if God so spare our life to be living in that time, to be prepared for the investigative judgment of the living, I just invite you to raise your hand wherever you are. God sees it. Brothers and sisters, God has a very heavy and special calling for us at this particular time. And the only thing that God is calling us to do is to simply cooperate. And in light of that, let us have a word of prayer. Dear Father in heaven, we know that everything that could have been discussed was not discussed, but I pray, dear Father, that at least to some degree an indelible impression was made upon our mind. We're so thankful that we can be able to go back to these studies and to review them and to share these things with others. Lord, this message is not merely for the remnant church, but it's for the entire world. The world needs to understand that the judgment is taking place, that it's soon to pass to the cases of the living, and we need to be found in Christ. We need His righteousness. And I just pray, dear Heavenly Father, that You would please keep us until this end, until we come back for our next session. In Jesus' name, amen.